Hi, and welcome back. In this video, I'm going to talk to you about points and working with points. So this is an internal data structure of tool version 3, and we are using this for a lot of procedural animation and designs. And it's quite a versatile tool, and you can build a lot of fancy things with that. And yeah, let's dive right in. So let's clear this background first. We don't need this. And we switch the background by pressing F2, switching the layout by pressing F2. And so what is a point? So there are, let's create a point here. Here we have a point. So a point is, it's a point in space. So it has a coordinate X, Y, Z. So, and we are using left-handed coordinate system because we're at X. Which means, so X is always pointing to the right side, Y is pointing upwards, and Z is pointing, I think, into the left corner. Z is pointing away from the camera, so into space. And then we have a fourth parameter, which we call W, and this can stand for the width or thickness or the current selection state and all kinds of things. And depending on how we combine different point operations, this can be a quite flexible way to combine stuff. And then we have the orientation, and this orientation is given as four parameters, and these are together, this forms a quaternion, so you don't have to mess with quaternions directly. There are tons of ways how to manipulate this rotation. But what this gives us is, this is all we need to, for instance, do some instantiation of geometry in set space. So we had this earlier. So everything that's only CPU and it's related to data structures is gray. So this is still on a CPU, and we can, we can, for instance, combine this now into a buffer on the graphics card. So yes, this is a very small buffer because it's only like these like 8x4, so it's like 32 bytes on the graphics card, but nevertheless it is on the graphics card. And then we can use this, for instance, to I think there should be like draw mesh at points. So if you now have a mesh, and let's say we load an OBJ here, and we this is a mesh, and by default we have this marble player object, and now we see that we can draw this object at this point. So if we adjust this point, we instantiate this object there, and now if we would have like multiple points and move this one somewhere here, so we have multiple meshes at different spaces. And we already see that if we select a point, then we see that we have a rotation axis and a rotation angle. So so you know, like we are now rotating around like this axis, and it's let's say we wanted to remove this around the green axis. Then we could say the rotation axis would be 0 for X and 1 for green, for up, and 0 for def. And now if we would return this, we could do so, and then we could of course take this out and spin it continuously by attaching it to the time. So of course this is kind of silly, but there are like tons of ways to create more points. And so one thing we could do, for instance, is we can use this radial G point thing, and this will already create like many more points directly on the graphics card. So if we double click here, we see, oh, this is like tons of parameters, and eventually this is a compute shader that does this on a graphics card. So this is also super fast. So we could create millions of these points on a graphics card every frame. And then we could say, instead of using all this small point list, we could use this like this radial thing here. And also with this, radial G points, you already have like a lot of fancy things. So since this is a very powerful operator, let's quickly move through that. So let's maybe change the count a little bit, so to something more manageable. And then, you know, we have the radios, kind of obvious. We have the radius offset, which means you can, for instance, start with zero and then go outwards, or you can offset this like a spiral. If you want to build a spiral, we have like these cycles here. So one cycle is like this. So if you would increase this, eventually you would come up with a cycle. We have a start angle, like this is useful for rotation. And of course, we have once again a center. And we have an offset. So offset meaning that whenever we have parameters that have the offset suffix, this means we can see this as an interpolation between like the original center used for the index 0 and this offset from the center for the index 16 in this case. So then of course we have a start angle, we talked about this, we have something I can talk about this in a second, closed circle. Of course, we have the axis, so we could change the orientation of the actual points. And we have W, in this case, W is used for the size of this replication. So this is actually, I think, it's not really evident, but the raw mesh at points uses W for the size of the replicated mesh. And then of course we could also have the W offset, which means we could start with small and then go increase the size and then build something like a spiral here. And then once again we have like this offset again, so we could change the offset of these over time. So this is already very fun, but we could do much more stuff with that. So maybe let's get rid of this and keep just these points. And one thing to work with these points is there's an operator called visualize points. And if we select this, then nothing happens because this guy is a we call it like a gizmo. And gizmos, these are helper objects that are only supposed to be visible if you have this toggle on. So in this toggle, toggle gizmos, I think it's called, this will, now you see the grid and also you see like these gizmos, and this will help you doing building stuff, but you don't want to see it in the final product, so you can switch it then off. Of course, you can override this. So you could say, no, wait a second. I want to see these gizmos all the time, no matter if this is enabled or not. And so maybe you have something, you render this into a render target, and then you do some glow or so. And then maybe you have like a super glow amount. And maybe, I don't know, if you would want to do this, because you like RGB values, then you could do this, but normally you wouldn't want to use these in production. So we click here to reset it, and now they're gone. And actually this was just fun, so let's get rid of these. So let's turn this on again, and maybe we reset all these things so we have our circle again. So what we can do with these points as well is we can not only replicate geometry, but we can also replicate points to other points. So we had this small little list here. So let's do this. So there is a repeat at G points. So this operator wants two things. And I'm seeing here that we earlier talked about parameter settings, and how we can adjust them. So this operator only makes sense with a two points list. So otherwise this is basically broken, it doesn't work. And so we can right click here and parameter settings and change this to required. And so now we see that even if this is collapsed, we will always see these two input parameters. And so now we take this one and say this is the target and this is the points I want to repeat. And if I now switch to this mode, nothing is happening because why not? Ah, because of course we want to visualize these points. So click them here. And now we see that we have two of these things. One is still rotating because we animated constantly. We can still like move this around or move this around, or we can actually move both around if we select them. And this is already like interesting. You can also do like super weird things with that. So let's say you wanted to combine these points into lines. Then there's a similar operator for that. I think it's a pair points for lines. And let's take this and let's take this. And then we can draw lines and maybe execute these into like an execution buffer here. And now we see that this is an interesting effect because we are taking this one here and maybe we so what's going on here? Let's dig this through this down. So maybe we disable this for a second here. So we are pairing the radial G points with these two points. And these two points, if I move them around, we see that yes, we have this point, and if we move this around, yes, we have this point here. And so this will go like one point to this, and one point to this, one point to this, one point to this. So it's probably not what we wanted, or at least not what I wanted. I was more thinking about taking this rotating thing and taking this original line thing and then rotate these two. So what else can we do? I was quickly mentioning the, let's get out of this, the close into circle. So if this is off, then we see, well, let's look at the visualized points and at this. So if we, and maybe we also maybe decrease the size here. So we have these points here, but if I zoom in, I see that the maybe if I increase the light, the width of this here, we see that this circle is not closed. And sometimes you want to have a full circle for, let's say you want to build like an arc, like a donut diagram or something, then you might want to you animate like the cycles here and map it to some kind of value. Or maybe we could also do this negative, and maybe if the start angle would be 19 or minus 90 or something, zoom also the, so like this could be like a like an arc or something. And then if you have a full cycle, we probably would want this to be connected. But the draw line doesn't know that you want to have this connected. So you can say, I want to close the circle, and this will insert like a double point at this location here to close these lines. So yeah, you can of course do all kinds of like really strange stuff with that. So you could take like one radial G point and repeat like a lot of points to a lot of points and draw these as you have like a lot of points. And then if, of course you can rotate points. So you could say, ah, I want to transform these points. Let's say there should be a transform points. So, you could actually move the target positions, but you can also, for instance, rotate these. And eventually you will get some, like a donut being described by points being repeated along a circular structure. So we change this radius here, maybe not this, but this radius. Then you see eventually a donut coming up. Then you can get points from all kinds of things. So you could also take like the mesh we loaded earlier. So our little marble player here, and there is points here. Mesh vertices to points, and you could do things like, oh, I want to replicate the circles on the marble player objects. Okay, like this now looks completely awkward. I think there should be like a set fog operator here. And if we decrease the fog, eventually we get like these weird spaghetti things. But if we would reduce the width here, and then maybe we don't transform these, and maybe take a full circle and shrink the radius down, then eventually we will see like these, whatever this is. It's like, I don't know. I guess some kind of fungi or so spreading over this. As I said, there are a lot of things you can do with this. So, for instance, there is you could sample like a texture to adjust these values. So you could say, let's say, sample point attributes. And maybe we bring in our introductional tutorial because it's an animated texture. We can use this. And then we take the input parameter points and output parameter points. And now we can use this operator. So maybe let's clean this up. So it should be a tutorial and should be easier to read. So we want to take the, wait a second, this is completely wrong. I wanted to take these and want to sample them, and then these should be the targets and these should be the ones I want to clone. Let's clean this up again. And now what we can do with this is, so we can use like either the brightness factor or red, green, or blue channel to do certain manipulation. So let's take the red and use it for W, and then we can say the red factor should be larger. And then we can see if we increase this, how maybe we can like tweak these parameters. And now eventually we will see how this is affecting the structure here. We see how this is moving across these lines. And you can adjust like where this lookup texture is being rotated and the size of it and so on. So this is very powerful for like all kinds of things. So it's really fun to play with that. Another thing you could do is right now, like everything is being completely procedural, which means that for every frame, we will update this list if it's required, and it will be like a completely predictable output no matter where you are in your animation. Which means like if we scrub this back and forth, it will always be okay. Right now, like this is a feedback simulation, so this is not really working as intended. But if this would be some kind of effect that is animated, it will always lead to the same result. Sometimes you want to have like some kind of animation that is like not completely predictable or easier to create interesting results to. And for this, we also have something similar like a particle animation. And so the easiest thing to set this up is keep points. What this does is it will take the result of all of what this is doing and mix it with an internal buffer of particles with unlimited lifetime, you could say. And so right now this is set to an update with mix original, like what is this, like 0.5%. And what it does is that I could now apply, for instance, noise to that. So now we see that this is like drifting with some kind of kernel noise back and forth. And but we also see that it's still trying to somehow maintain this original shape. So which means that if I increase this value here, it will go back to our original thing. Or if I don't say no, don't update at all, it will like go nuts and it will not be size restricted at all. And sometimes having like this mixture of like something that is like completely wild and like going somewhere, and then eventually, so updating it with mix original zero will do nothing, because we are not mixing any of these into like this current thing. But if we are now slowly add increase this value, we can eventually bring it back to whatever we want to see there. What we can also do is if you start thinking in this point way of doing things, it's a really fun way to exploring procedural design stuff. So for instance, of course there is mix points. So there's an operator called mix points that blends two point sets. And with this, you could do things like, okay, I have my noise thing here. And I have my original point set here. And maybe I want to connect this pair for lines with this and connect these as well with lines or lines. So this might get like super slow now. It might not even work. Why is it not working? Key points, original, of course this was stupid. We don't want to draw this as lines, but we don't want to, let's start with drawing these as points. Put them here. Maybe we color them a little bit into some color here. And so now what we can do is, we can say, I want to blend this between these two to do some kind of interpolation. And of course, you could again like transform these points and so on. So there's a lot of like ways what you can do with these kind of like operations. And of course, you could use these points again to, I don't know, instantiate donuts or something, whatever you want there. I will quickly walk you through the operators we have in this section. So fx points. So we have the convention that whenever we use the prefix apply, then this is working for this simulated buffer that you can create with key points. So it will not create a new copy of points, it will not create a new list, but it will actually create, it will manipulate this original buffer. So a little bit like a particle animation or particle effect. So let's go on here again. So we have lib fx. So we have, and you can probably ignore these three, this. So maybe I should like really sort these out into like meaningful categories. We have a point cloud from object. This will take an object and will scatter not only on the vertex position but on all over the surface. We have points to buffer. This would bring points from the GPU to the GPU. We had this already. We can ignore this because it's an internal thing. We can ignore this because it's internal. It is all internal because I'm in a particle. I want to talk about points, not particles. Damn you. Okay, I was completely confused. Okay, so we had add noise and apply noise. So this will create a new copy with noise applied to it. So it will like scatter things, you could say. We had draw lines, we covered this already. We had line points. This will, this is a grayscale operator, which means it will create points on a CPU, which sometimes is useful because, or maybe, what am I doing here? Points. So, drag this here. We can look, take a look at this, and you will see it will create points on a CPU. And some comment, so whenever we have this not a number thing here, we will use this as a separator. So if we combine this, how do I explain this? So I should explain this because it's important. So if we have a grid points here and we look at these, if we say visualize points and we enable Orgismo, and here we have our point. Or point grid. Maybe we want to not use the cell size but the bonds. So there's our 1x1 grid here. So if we would connect all these points with lines. So let's draw lines and let's take these two and combine them into something new. Then we see how it also connects like all the diagonals. It takes like all these and has a back line back into the next. We see that there's a line going there and the line going there, and eventually it will go one over. And of course, frequently we don't want this. And that's why we insert these separator not a number lines here, these points, to make sure that the lines are not being connected. Okay, let's go back into our list of operators. We have four points, fx points. So we can append points, so you can concatenate two lists of points. You can blend continuously. Eventually, I guess I should make this more consistent and call this apply mix or rename mix into like blend. Then we talked a lot about RadioG points, was useful. We can draw points. We can apply centric force, like move points towards something. We can apply directional force. We can apply follow mesh surface. This one is fun, but I think I talked about this earlier. We had apply noise, we had this already. We had linear G points. We talked about the mesh vertex points. We talked about keeping point buffers and blending them. Then we have draw quads. So right now we have like a lot of different methods to draw sprites. And eventually these might need to be consolidated. But you can say that points, it will draw round dots. Sometimes you want to have quads, and sometimes like quads in space, and sometimes you want to have quads that are facing the camera, so these billboards here. And sometimes you want to have super complex things like almost like a particle system where you have like a driven animation. So we use this thing here. So we had get points we covered, we have sample pointer we covered, ready g points like these two again are on a CPU. Sometimes, as I said, it's useful because on a CPU it's much easier to write things and debug them and do applications that are not easy to do once you are on a GPU. We had the pair points for lines, we have transform points, we had collect spawn points. This one, I'm not sure if I should cover this. Maybe I will quickly cover this because it's kind of interesting. So let's build a quick example again. So let's move down here and let's start somewhere from scratch. So we had our load OBJ and we had our marble player. And let's say we want to render this our marble player and turn on the gizmos here. And maybe we want to have like small little highlight effects on all the vertices of this. So we get like the points of this thing, and let's draw some points. And let's take these two and combine them into, oh, this work nicely, into like a list. And maybe reduce the size here a little bit. And let's say we want to like pick one of these and do like a small animation there on the GPU. So it should be like a lot of things that could go out there. For this, we could pick a point. So this will pick the point, the first index of this list, and it will not scatter it and return a GPU buffer with this one single point. And then we can say, ah, I want to collect this point I just picked as a spawn point. And so let's say every time I pick something, I will increase. I will increase an index so I can collect multiple of these points. So okay, it's now getting confusing, but I guess once you see what's going on there, it will be easier to understand. So like draw was draw codes way. So now if you put this in here. We see that stuff is happening at this one single index there all the time. And we see that there seems to be some kind of animation going on. So let's clean this up a little bit. So what we can now do is say, ah, we only want to collect points, let's say, on the beat or something. So let's take a counter. And has value increased? And only if the value has increased, we want to actually collect points. See, like, only if this is going somewhere, we're collecting a point, and maybe we convert this into my cat is playing somewhere. Float to integer, and then we are picking another start index. This means now we see this, so this is moving along. Maybe we increase this speed a little bit. Now we see how these are like moving along all over this surface here. And now we can start to tweak these parameters and say, okay, maybe eventually they should fade out. And maybe eventually they should also like scale out. And yeah, maybe they should. I don't know, maybe it's like ribbons or something, or yeah. But you get the point. We are the point. Very funny. So we are picking things and doing stuff with these. So okay, this looks like kind of like really strange. Maybe we remove this and maybe take a blob and set this as a texture here. And yeah, we see that this could be some kind of particle effect. And then yeah, we had this earlier. We want maybe the resolution not to be dependent on the input output requested resolution. What you could also do is like, okay, if I'm collecting these points, like this is a buffer, and we had this already. If we apply a noise to this buffer, and let's say I want to keep a trail of these points and draw lines. You can do now. You see how these are like moving all over the place and emitting something like particle effects or so. Yeah. Okay. Maybe I should practice this example to make it more concise. But I hope I got across what this collect span points can be used for. And one thing about like this pick points, if we increase this getter thing here, maybe to one, this means getter this by 100%, this will pick now a random point somewhere on the mesh and not go, yeah, basically take this index, scatter it by 100% across the index, and so this, every time this change index change, it will take a pick a random index from this mesh. Okay, this video is already getting way too long. Let's move on. So we had collect spawn points and pick points and randomize points, so you can scatter stuff. Let's quickly randomize stuff. So we have this thing here. And one thing which sometimes comes in useful is, so I have this buffer here already, and I now want to like I want to insert something here. So yeah, yes, I could move this here and like insert it or insert it into this connection, but I could also click on this output randomize points to insert it before splitting the connection. And of the insert selected, you could say I want to, let's say, randomize like the position here. For yeah, I don't know why you want to do this, but you could. Then let's go back to points. So repeat pair points. We had this already. Randomize points for points position. So this can be useful if you want to have like a continuous base that wraps around at like cube borders. So if a particle is being moving and it's being moving out of that side, then it will reappear on another side. This might be useful if you want to wrap something around, for instance, the camera position. Then we have billboard, so drawing more points. This pairs points is like this one is kind of interesting. So you could push points away if they are too close to each other. So this should actually have an apply prefix because it's working, manipulating the input buffer. Offset points is like you can move them around. So you're not moving it, transforming like the whole constellation of points, but you're moving each individual points, and for instance you could offset it from the surface. Point trail, we had this earlier, it will build a trail buffer. You're seeing this here. Soft transform points is super useful. Yeah, I will quickly show this because I think this is like a really fun operator to play with. So let's take like this thing here. Once again, we insert this into here. So this will take a volume. I eventually have to address like the volume type here. So it's an enumeration. But we see the inner and the outer volume. This volume has a center and a fall off. This is the fall off here. And what we can do with this is we can say everything inside this volume is going to be, for instance, scaled. So we scale this down. And now if you change the soft transform here, you get some really interesting effects. And this is like very, very powerful operator. Let's say you wanted to, you have like a noise field, but within a certain area, let's scatter these even more. And let's say within, we want to have like a flat surface where like our marble players are standing. So we could actually say we increase the volume size here. And maybe increase the volume height. So, and then we can push all these down. So build like a floor. And this could also be used for, you could bind this to yeah, to an offset or something. Yeah, it's a, I think it's a really interesting operator. And one thing that's also nice is that you can rotate things, and this rotation works like it's like a twisting thing. So it will apply the orientation not only 160 degrees, but you can take multiple revolvements with that. So yeah, let's move back to FX points. So we had dispersed points, offset points, point wheel, soft transform points, we just said. Ah, and there's an example. Let's look at this example. What does it do? So we see that, yeah. Let's look at this example. We have some points. We randomize these points. We add some noise. We have this point wheel there. And after, yes, of course, you can apply more, like point wheel just creates another buffer, and of course, a buffer with points, and you can manipulate these points, so you can pick them and apply, or you can apply forces or soft transform. And yeah, basically, this is what this does. So, running through points. Yeah, we can subdivide line points, so it will go through like a list of points and interpolate between these points and smooth them out. We can, like, this is an internal parameter that helps you to maybe, yeah, that's too much detail. I'm not going in there. Mix, we talked about this. We can draw these quads. I talked about this. Where we have two different ways of drawing lines. So, like the draw ray lines. This is more like a 3D way of doing, of connecting lines. I should talk about this. And yeah, I should cover this because it's actually important. So, if I create already a point list, the G points, and draw lines. And this only example, let's turn on this. And if I now stick to that and I decrease the number of corners, and maybe I close this. So yeah, like here we have our square. So one problem is that this thing here, it will try to draw these lines screen aligned. So it will ignore the orientation, the width, and the width is like almost drawing in 2D, which is sometimes just what you want. You know, you don't want to really care, or it doesn't really work. Oh, yeah, I have to look at this. But most of the time, the metering should work. I think there is a meter limit or something. But sometimes this doesn't work if the line ends behind the camera. So then we stop drawing. We can't draw this because we don't really know how to compute a meter for that. And for this use case, you could use the draw ray lines. And let's color these. Execute. Execute So we see like that even like these rail lines, they will not really connect and the draw like the meter correctly, but they will work even if you are inside the set of lines. Oh boy, this was a complicated explanation. Sorry about that. Then yeah, we have a find closest point on mesh. This is super useful. So you can project a point on a mesh. An effect parameter, we don't really need this. We we can look at this example. So this will like use the collect points to draw stuff on a mesh. This sometimes can be useful. And again, you could look into how this is being done. So it looks kind of scary, but most of the things here is shading, and the actual point stuff, it's not that complicated. So and you see there are a lot of things that are not even connected. Let's clean this up, save. So let's clean this up and save. Why is there so much not connected? Even more stuff. Remove and save. Yeah, not connected. Okay, and fx point reflection lines. Yeah, you can reflect rays from surfaces. So for a project I'm working right now. You can snap points to other points. You can sample points. So you this was like you can if you have for instance like a circle and you know that you have let's try this. I forgot about how this works actually. So we have radio G point, we draw lines and we execute, we take this and draw points and this, and I guess this needs an input point. We should change this again. Parameter settings required. So much things that need to be cleaned up. And so I think, yeah, there, so we can take the color here, the size. So we can take an input point structure and basically sample points from this other structure. I think it's kind of obvious what it does. And of course you can change like the sample range or let's say you want to have like a small thing walking along this. So you can do things like this. Okay. And loop fx points and you see there this list definitely needs some cleanup, but there's a lot of things you can do with these points. I guess if you are checking out a new version of tool, this list will be cleaned up and I will sort this out into drawing and manipulating points. And the nice thing about points is that you could actually write your own shaders with that, and this is like super easy. Let's take like this mixed G points here. So yes, this looks kind of intimidating, but most of the time like you will reuse like this setup. And the only thing that's relevant is this this compute shader here, and then you could go in there and copy your own compute shader. And if you look at this compute shader, it's all what it does. It takes like two points and blends between these points. So I will get into details on how to write these compute shaders in another video, but just want to take the point across that the power is not only that there are a bunch of operators that you can combine, but that you can combine them with operators you write on your own, and that will do the job you want. I think That's all for this video. So this was kind of way too long again. I'm sorry about that. And yes, I know the audio quality of these tutorial videos is not really great, and it's kind of all over the place. But yeah, tell me what you think. I'm planning to record a proper tutorial series eventually with like cleaned up UI structure and like making some planning of what do I want to actually talk about and preparing the examples. But for now, it is what it is. So bear with me. If you have any questions, feedback, and so on, reach out on Discord or Twitter, and yeah, tell me what you think. Bye.